I hope those in the Zoom meet can hear us. Thank you for joining us this morning for this singular talk to commemorate the 80th anniversary of the invasion and fall of Singapore in 1942. And it is our privilege this morning to have Professor Brian Farrell from the NUS Department of History, who will give us his talk entitled, Whose Worst Disaster? The Long Shadow of the Fall of Singapore 80 Years On. Professor Farrell is one of the foremost scholars on the fall of Singapore. He is Professor of Military History at the NUS History Department. Without further ado, I invite Brian to deliver his talk. Brian, please.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here. I hope you can all hear me at home or wherever you're Zooming in. And those of you here in the room have to put up with me using a microphone, which is usually unnecessary. But for our Zoom audience, we have to do it so that they can catch it on the recording. So we're a few months late, but here we are in person as well as on Zoom, talking about Whose Worst Disaster, the Long Shadow of the Fall of Singapore 80 Years On. I gave Tim an abstract for this talk, and I'll just put it up there so that all of you who haven't yet had a chance to look at it can see in a summary paragraph what we're going to do here this morning, what we're going to talk about. I won't actually read it out for you because I'm reliably assured that everybody got taught to read in primary school here. So the point of reading out text and slides that people can read for themselves has always escaped me, and yet lots of speakers do it. Reflex, I guess. Who labeled this? It was Winston Churchill, Prime Minister of the United Kingdom at the time, throughout most of the Second World War, the man on the spot and the pivotal man in the central direction of the war for the British Empire. 1948, he began to publish his memoirs. Now, Churchill, in addition to being a politician of some note, was also quite a literary man. In fact, he won the Nobel Prize for Literature for his very long, multi-volume History of the English-Speaking Peoples. He used words well, right? It was said of him that he mobilized the English language and sent it into war. The third volume of his memoirs, published about 70 years ago, contained at the beginning of one of the most painful chapters that he had to write for the whole six volumes, a sentence describing the impact of the Japanese onslaught on Western Allied territories in Southeast Asia that began in December 1941. He labeled the fall of Singapore the worst disaster in the military history of the British Empire. Now, because he was who he was, this resonated throughout time and space. We have it still. Churchill labeled this, therefore it is. There are books with Churchill sayings. If Churchill said something, then we must take note of it. This one stuck a label on the forehead of this event, which it's next to impossible to peel off, no matter how hard you try. If you take it literally, for example, it's absolute nonsense. Certainly, and Churchill would have known this, he was a devoted historian who'd written a biography of his ancestor, the Duke of Marlborough. He knew very well that really the worst disaster in the military history of the British Empire occurred in 1781 when they failed to defeat the 13 colonies and were forced to acknowledge the independence of what became the United States. That was a game changer for world history as well as the British Empire. But it was definitely the worst disaster for Winston Churchill, certainly in terms of his wartime premiership. So that raises right away an important point here. Nuance, unpacking, and problematizing something. We historians usually wind up being hated by intelligent, interested general readers who don't study history for a living, because we take something that they like to see as interesting, even dramatic, full of life and color, and we nuance and complicate and problematize it to death, making us the spoilsport party pooper. Well, I'm afraid there's really no choice about all of this, because floating around in every story, and this story is certainly dramatic, there is a clash between a concept in this case, disaster, and a context, in this case, what happened in Singapore and Southeast Asia in 1942. And like it or not, we have to take a look at that, and I'm afraid that means unpacking. In this case, on this topic, unpacking, and I move off my stopwatch there, leads us towards the theme of consequences. This is a pretty big one for a historian. The consequences of something, cause and effect. What difference did it make? Did it matter? If it's something that's of no interest or significance to anyone other than the people who experienced at that time and place, it may not rise above the level of antiquarianism. Something of some interest if you were there at the time, otherwise, who cares, so what? To my dismay, no one wants to hear my running description of my son turning 6 and how much fun it was, except those who also know him. Personally, I think the entire world should be interested, but for some reason, they're not. So my diary entries of his birthday will be antiquarian to the world at large. Unless, of course, he becomes president of the United States or something like that. Consequences are problematic, too. You could, for example, it's been done, draw a link in a chain of cause and effect between the fall of Rome and the outbreak of the Second World War. I don't know why you would do that, unless you're writing a history of the world or a comprehensive history of Europe, but it is possible. It roughly approximates to something French historians have termed for many decades now, la longue durée, the unfolding of a chain of connections between events over a large span of time and often across a wide span of space. The trick there is to decide whether something is really a meaningful comparison. Nearly everybody who writes a learned study of the causes of the Second World War will not take it back to the fall of Rome. Because la longue durée may be literally connectable, but in this case, it's not practically very useful, not even as an intellectual exercise. A popular theme in the search for consequences in historical explanation is also the idea of the fork in the road, or choices. Now, I like this one. There's been a foolish battle for decades between historians who believe that individuals do not matter at all, right? And they hold up a straw man or a straw woman and say, the great man theory of history is bullshit. Well, yes, it is, because one individual doesn't all by themselves drive history writ large. And those who argue that individuals can matter, they do matter because their life occurs in a context and they sometimes do make choices which do matter. I think anyone who lived through the presidency of Donald Trump would have a hard time maintaining the argument that individuals don't matter and it doesn't really have any significance on history. That election mattered a very great deal. That's one of many examples. So you need to nuance this, right? So instead of it being a binary choice between only great profound forces on the one hand or a big titanic individual on the other, naturally it's something more complicated. It's an interplay between context, circumstances, profound forces, individuals. And so the choices in question are really a range of choices. And what historians often seek to understand is whether that range of choices was wide, numerous, and flexible, or whether it was very narrow, very circumscribed, very tight. One wonders, for example, at the range of choices placing Vladimir Putin right now, today. He's painted himself into his own corner, and to hell with him, he deserves whatever terrible thing happens next to him. But his range of choices have clearly changed between February 23rd and today. As to whether or not the choices he makes will be decisive in history, we will not yet know. We, all of us, may never live long enough to know. That's one of the points of my whole talk today, the perspective that time gives. Of course, there's also the issue of turning points, and that's pretty close to choices. Can history be affected? Has it been affected by great moments, great events, the conjuncture of things that moves the vector of change or development from one path onto another in some way, shape, or form? a favorite one among historians of modern Asia would be the ultimate consequences of the decision of the Tokugawa shogunate in Japan to virtually isolate itself from the rest of the world. It's not true that it was completely 100% absolutely cut off. That was never the case. But access was severely restricted and limited to certain very tightly controlled points of contact for centuries. And one of the results of this was that there was dramatic change in the rest of the world, not so much in Japan. So in 1853, with the arrival of what the Japanese called the Black Ships of Commodore Perry in the United States Navy, and look at the darkness of the image with which this Japanese cartoon portrays it. The message there is very clear. Japan is being wrenched against its will by force majeure back into a world it tried to keep its distance from, keep at arm's length. And supposedly that was fruit of the poison tree, and it led to all kinds of terrible things in the relations between Japan and the rest of the world over the next 90 years. That's a candidate for the argument that turning points matter. In our quest to try to understand consequences as an instrument of explanation and understanding in history, we run up against the danger of distinguishing between hindsight, which is bad, and perspective, which really honestly is neutral. And the best I can do to distinguish between the two is to suggest that to use hindsight to try to understand or explain anything in history is to draw from the fact that you know something that the people who lived through it at the time could not reasonably ever have been expected to know. So you're judging after the fact. Whereas perspective, if you have been able to see undercurrents or underlying dimensions or forces emerge from a decision with the unfolding of time, well, that could be neutral. Perhaps a favorite one there is whether or not we apply hindsight or draw on perspective to determine whether or not the aborted experiment to merge Singapore and the mainland into Malaysia was ever a wise or reasonable course of action to begin with. Was that a marriage doomed to divorce? Or was it more complicated than that? I would suggest that after 57 years, perspective can give us some insight to this. But when we try to use it, to apply it, to draw some conclusions about the decisions made by those involved, we still have to bear in mind that there were only so many things that they could reasonably have been expected to know. So hindsight, bad, perspective, neutral, history and consequences, that's obviously what we're looking for when we're trying to understand something like disaster. Let me just remind you of the bare facts. The Japanese overran Malaya and Singapore in 100 days. They launched their invasion of Malaya and Thailand on the 8th of December 1941, and they forced the defenders of Singapore to capitulate on the 15th of February 1942. This was about 50 days faster than anticipated. The Japanese were on a very tight timetable, but it amounted to a great big humiliation for the British, because not only had they been defeated by an Asiatic power, their term, not mine, but they had also been dealt with very quickly. They had been given the bum's rush out of Malaya, a territory that they'd been dominating for very many decades, would have been expected to put up a better fight. This was a huge humiliation. A much bigger, more keener, the optics of this were terrible. It was a much deeper humiliation than any defeat they suffered in Europe, because of course the dynamics were that ever since the late 19th century, with the imposition of Western power on East Asia, no first-class power was supposed to have an unmanageable problem dealing with an oriental power. You will understand that these are the terms they use themselves, not inventions that I'm coming up with, right? So there was certainly humiliation here. Let's leave disaster aside for the moment, but there was definitely humiliation. It was, without a doubt, a grave military setback. It wasn't just embarrassing. It was a military problem as well. In 6 months, the Japanese threw the Western powers out of the entirety of ASEAN, all of it. They dominated everything between Dhaka and Darwin in 6 months. They left Portuguese Timor alone, but that's because it suited them to do that, right? Tiny little enclave. So there's no doubt that it was a grave military setback. It changed the course of the war. It made things a lot tougher, and it led to a lot of pain, death, and suffering for all concerned. It certainly shaped the subsequent British war against Japan. And I'll talk more about that in a few minutes. Right? So I'm not for a moment suggesting that it was anything other than a really bad development for the British. Not sure yet I'm going to agree with Winston Churchill, but this was a really grave defeat. The defense of Singapore had been the hinge of British plans to resist any attempt by a hostile power, Japan, to challenge British and Western positions in East and Southeast Asia. So yeah, this mattered. But look at the picture that I've got up there in front of you. Anybody recognize it? Yeah, it's General Douglas MacArthur, Supreme Commander of Allied Powers in charge of the invasion of Japan that never had to occur, signing the instrument of surrender on board the USS Missouri in Tokyo Bay on September the 2nd, 1945. And does anybody recognize this tall, thin British general behind him? Yeah, that's Lieutenant General Arthur Percival, who was forced to surrender Singapore. He was commander of Malaya Command, in command of ground forces defending Singapore, and he had had to surrender on February 15th, 1942. My point, the Allies won the war. The Japanese won the battle for Singapore, but they lost the war. So right away, that raises questions about using a label like disaster, or it should anyway. As the British took Singapore back, they won the war. There they are in Tokyo Bay, reclaiming their territory, which they then stayed in for another 25 years. This was reversed in 1945. The Japanese Empire fell apart very quickly. It was torn apart, mainly by the Americans, and it collapsed in chaos and confusion, which had dire consequences for Southeast Asia. Nasty war of independence in Indonesia, and a far longer, bloodier, more consequential conflict in Vietnam. A direct result of the initial extent of the Japanese conquest and the sudden total collapse of Japanese power, triggered, of course, by the use of the nuclear weapons. So the consequences of the fall of Singapore, I would say the ultimate consequence is this. It's not the humiliation of the British being marched off to captivity in Changi in February 1942. It's the ultimate fate of the imperial power that took Singapore from the British in the first place. They did so for a larger purpose. The war wasn't about Singapore, and this is how it ended. And that happened in Japan, not in an allied territory. Pride went before the fall, absolutely. Their relatively easy conquest of Southeast Asia went to the head of the Japanese High Command, which, as they had never been able to since 1935, remained unable to coordinate coherently at a national level, decide how to organize themselves and make sure that they were working all on the same page. And they wound up losing control of the war in June and July of 1942, even before the American mobilization had really begun to project American full power. The Japanese found themselves trying to hang on to about a fifth of the earth without anywhere near the strength to do so. And they paid a terrible ultimate price for it. But during the war itself, what the fall of Singapore did was knock the British onto the sidelines. It's necessary to understand this. It's really important to do so. Before 1941, the United States was not the dominant power in the world. It did not stick its nose in everywhere and trying to regulate everything for everyone. And it was not the overwhelming juggernaut that dominated the world's political economy. It was the largest economy and potentially the strongest power in the world, but it had pulled away in 1919, 1920. From what that suggested. It had tried to avoid projecting on that level and being the global superintendent of the new order that it sought to build. The largest preeminent Western power in Asia before 1941 was the British Empire, far more visible than the United States. That changed, and it changed forever. This defeat in Southeast Asia in 1942, reinforced by the loss of Burma and the Japanese success at shoving the British Indian armies back to India itself, That meant that the British from now on were forced to follow an American lead. The Americans took charge. They became the preeminent, dominant, driving power of the alliance, which meant they ultimately had the biggest voice in how to fight the war against Japan. And that certainly meant that in the end, they earned the largest voice in reordering Asia at the peace table after the war. So this mattered. It was no small thing. This was the end of British imperial preeminence as the Western power in Asia. But for the empire itself, was this melodrama? Because after all, what subsequently ensued in the British Empire, during and especially after the war, was not revolution, but evolution. In Southeast Asia, even the most rapid transition to political sovereignty and independence in Burma occurred largely without bloodshed between the British and the Burmese. Largely, right? Burmese made absolutely no bones about their desire for rapid, if not immediate, independence, but the two needed each other enough that there was an interdependent negotiation. It's been well said, I don't need to labor the point here, that the British eased out of their empire with a great deal less blood and violence. They did do some both than, say, the French or the Dutch. Particularly east of Suez, there really weren't all that many revolutionary challenges to force the British to leave at gunpoint. That's not to say there wasn't horrific violence. The partition of the Punjab will stick forever in South Asian history as an absolute nightmare, a true catastrophe. But that was inflicted on the peoples of South Asia by themselves, with the British dragged in as an unwilling participant, yes, but not as the principal culprit, not that time. The British Empire remained in Southeast Asia for another generation. And when the British eventually did finally leave and abandon the position of hard power in Southeast Asia, those who were being abandoned complained and protested about it. So that raises some interesting questions about the impact of the fall of Singapore on the relationship between Britain on the one hand and the territories that it administered here on the other. But of course, we must also look at the consequences of the fall for Singapore itself. So let's do that. Long since passed my slide chart here. Anniversaries tend to provoke reflections. The mural that you see before you comes from the Chinese Nanjing. Have any of you heard of the famous warehouse in Shanghai and the Battle of the 800 Heroes? The Battle of Shanghai in autumn of 1937 is generally regarded by historians now as the first major battle of the Second World War. The Kuomintang and their National Revolutionary Army actually picked a fight with the Japanese. They did this deliberately to try and escalate to open war and drag everybody else in. It was a long and bloody battle. It lasted 2.5 months. And as the Japanese were finally pushing the Chinese forces out of central Shanghai to try and delay them and prevent them from cutting off the majority of Chinese combat troops, which were getting out through the north, the commanders left behind a battalion of 800 or so soldiers in a warehouse along the river, along the creek facing the international settlement. And they stubbornly held it for days and fought nearly to the death and eventually became romanticized. And here, it's now a museum and you can go and see the whole building turned into a battle site approximating what the curators thought it must have been in 1937. That was all done on an anniversary. From 2010 to 2014, the PRC rediscovered the Second World War, significantly altered its public memorialization of it, restored the Kuomintang to the principal place that they deserved because they had led the national resistance to the Japanese occupation of China. The communists had been a relatively small force in the remote Northwest, and significantly rebuilt a lot of the sites of commemoration, including Nanjing. This was a time for reflection. Anniversaries always do provoke reflections, especially years that end in zero. I suppose one motive would be the less we forget motive. And everybody would have their own different interpretation of this, so that we don't do it again, so that we honor the sacrifice of those who gave their lives, so that people who are aging and who are trying to remember the comrades that they lost would have some solace in the fact that society is not just moving on and forgetting them. There are as many different spin-offs of the Less We Forget motive as there are people who are sharing it. Another one would be the civil society motive. It would be good in the interest of building a strong, healthy, critically aware civil society to engage even the darker moments of its history. This is a very strong theme in Singapore's national education curriculum, in which the Second World War, both the fall of Singapore and the Japanese occupation, have always played a central role for the obvious fact that it's a lived and learned experience. And at least when national education began in the late 1990s, there were still a great many Singaporeans who could be brought into classrooms and tell the secondary school kids about what they remembered when they were their age and living under Japanese occupation. So you could reach out and touch this history. It justifies total defense. It justifies national service. It justifies the argument that Singapore, being a small place in the middle of a rather turbulent neighborhood, needs always to look to its own defenses and keep its house in order in a variety of ways. And here is a lived and learned experience to point to the truth that you never know what can happen. So a civil society which is resilient is one that is able to confront and engage these kinds of memories. The problem of circumstances in human nature also arises. Possibly the best way to explain this is to use the nuclear weapons against Japan in 1945. It's next to impossible to have an uncontroversial discussion about that now because of all the baggage that's been superimposed on the concept of nuclear since 1945. It now seems immoral to the point of sheer evil to even consider using a nuclear weapon on anyone, anywhere, for any reason. But this is not the standard by which historians really should evaluate and try to understand. I didn't say judge, I said try to understand the decisions made in 1945. To do that, you have to remember what the circumstances were at the time. What had preceded that decision? What was going on at the time? What pressures existed? What reasons were put forward for doing this? Human nature may be a constant, but it has to deal with very different circumstances and very different contexts. And you need to be very clear about how you can match the two if you're trying to evaluate and understand. So there are lots of different reasons why we reflect on various things in our search for consequences. And one thing that I think historians should always try to emphasize is that that must always pay due respect, serious due respect to context and particularity. The example that I just mentioned is one. Another one would be the SAF's constant interest in asking people like me, what lessons does the fall of Singapore have for defending Singapore today? Well, in terms of the use of military force to defend Singapore, very few, because it's 2022. Japan is not an empire anymore. It's not using piston-engined aircraft. I mean, I could go on and on, right? So much has changed, technology, politics, Singapore, you name it. But in deeper, more indirect, abstract considerations, well, yeah, quite a few. I mean, yes, at the time, Singapore was part of a superpower, but the guiding brain of the superpower was busy. It regarded Singapore as a remote outpost. One of the least convincing arguments I've ever heard is the idea that Singapore was betrayed by the British. Number one, they lost a lot of guys here. Number two, there's never been an example in human history of an imperial metropolis sacrificing itself in order to protect what it regarded as an outpost. Never, never, never. So yes, you may have great and powerful friends, but they may be busy. Hence total defense, large national service, you name it, right? And there are also circumstances about, you know, what is the geography of Singapore? How does that change over time? What can we learn from 1942? Context is king, particularity is important. However much things change over time, we look for continuities too. But there will always be something singular about some particular situation. If you want to learn about how to defend Singapore in complicated circumstances, the Second World War isn't a very good historical example because that would require another global war. Confrontation with Indonesia might be. That was a messy, complicated, low-intensity regional conflict. Something like that could happen again. So apple to apple, orange to orange. But if you're trying to present an analytical explanation of history and you set context aside or you ignore particularity, trying to evaluate what things were like at that exact time and place, you're probably not going to come up with anything very persuasive. So we don't deny trajectories, patterns, recurrences, continuities, not by any means. They're there. But they need to share. They need to share the room of explanation with understanding and framing the context and recognizing and identifying the particularity. The other point to say before I move on is the particularliness of the number 80. 20 years ago, I organized and hosted a conference at the then brand new cultural center at the edge of campus on this very subject, the fall of Singapore. And I called it 60 years on. And one of the ways that I pitched this conference to various foundations which helped us financially supporting it, this was the early years of national education. I said, here's a marvelous opportunity to take the school children of Singapore and put them in contact with mature historians who are studying this after a passage of time when state papers have been released for researchers' use, and also to meet veterans who are still around. They were in their 20s when it happened, and 60 years later, they're in their 80s. So you can put the three generations together and they can all share insights with each other. I was making that argument to solicit money, but it actually worked somewhat to my surprise, made me a little bit less cynical. It kind of worked that way. Much tougher to do that, 80, right? 80 is a lifetime of a person fortunate enough to be living in a developed, rich country with good medical care and diet, right? So how many people with teenage memories of Japanese occupation of Singapore are with us still? I would imagine not very many, because they'd all be well into their 90s. So 80 is on the cusp. It's a year that ends in zero, and that always provokes the media to ask us, what about? But it's also on the cusp of something passing completely into history altogether, in the sense that rather soon, there will be no person alive who actually experienced and witnessed that. And then something really does pass into history. That can have a significant impact. We are not yet at the stage where the atrocities of the Holocaust can be digested in discussion in Europe without it provoking strong emotions. We are at the stage where the atrocities committed by Napoleon's troops in Spain 215 years ago and immortalized by the great painter Goya with his paintings of Spanish guerrillas being executed by French soldiers. That can be discussed now without any emotion at all. That doesn't stir up any emotional or nationalist controversy or anger, even though it was a nasty, brutal, horrible thing to do, because enough passage of time has sanitized the event, has distanced those discussing it from those who witnessed it or experienced it. We're not quite there with 80 years, but we're on the cusp of it. So maybe it's the last chance to stand and look at something which is about, if not dramatic, to pass literally into history and beyond the reach of any living person. We now, for example, have no surviving living veterans of the Great War, the First World War. They're all gone. Something to note. What to make of it? Really not sure myself, but something to note. So let's play around with some definitions. As I always tell my students, somewhere in any question worth answering as a historian, there is a concept, something abstract, something that you can always look for. And in this case, it's disaster. What is a disaster? I would suggest that a disaster is an event or an incident from which there are unavoidable, unescapable, serious consequences. Something that mattered, it was significant enough that it hurt you. So you're driving your car and you get into an accident, you smash your car, you total it, you hurt somebody else. So you have to pay a bloody bomb to replace your car because the accident is your fault, the insurance rules against you. That's a disaster. Right? Now, there's a scale here. We're in a hierarchy. There's also a catastrophe. And I would suggest, whatever the dictionary says, that a catastrophe is worse than a disaster. This is an event or an incident or a development which has crippling consequences. So it's that same car accident, it's your fault, only this time you're badly hurt. In fact, you lose the use of your legs and you have to spend the rest of your life in a wheelchair. So those are literally crippling consequences. That's catastrophic. Well, there's still one more, right? You all know where it's going. And there's a terminal. Your fault, your accident, and you wind up getting killed in the process. So what I'm suggesting here is that disaster is a very bad thing. The word exists for a reason, but it's not necessarily fatal, final, or terminal. Losing the 13 colonies was not fatal or final to the British Empire. Losing Singapore did not cost the British Empire the war against Japan or the Second World War. It mattered, it wasn't insignificant, but it wasn't terminal. It might not even have been catastrophic. In fact, I would suggest it wasn't. So when we're going to take Sir Winston's magisterial definition and the label he put on the forehead and subject it to critical analysis, the first thing we do is we try and decide, as historians, what do we think disaster should mean? Either per se or in context. In this case, for military geopolitical events. So the key to this, in my view, is perspective. First, you need to decide what frame of evaluation are you trying to use to determine whether this is the worst disaster. Now, the reason Churchill provoked my instant rejection of his argument is because of the sentence he used. The worst disaster in the military history of the British Empire. Sorry, Sir Winston, but that opened you up to a 300-year global time span, right, in which I needed to look at everything and decide that I didn't agree with you. If he'd said it was the worst disaster in Britain's war against Japan, I would have said, yep, bang on, agree, 100%. But he didn't. He said, in the military history of the British Empire. So whether we're going to agree that something is a disaster or not, we first start by deciding what is our frame of evaluation going to be. How much time, how much space, what sort of boundaries are there within which we'll try to understand this? We frame the context. Then it's horizontal. Who are you? This was the worst military defeat the Australian Army ever suffered. It was one of the worst military defeats the British Indian Army ever suffered. In the end, it led Japan to a path to disaster. It wasn't just a disaster for the British. Nobody comes well out of this in the end. So it really depends on who you are. Now, Churchill, of course, framed that by saying for the British Empire. Okay, so we're moving beyond him now and expanding the discussion. But it also depends on the vertical. At what point in time are you talking about here? I mean, in 1942, this is most definitely a disaster for the British. 1945, is it disaster redeemed? I mean, they've won the war, they're in Tokyo Bay accepting the Japanese surrender, they've got Singapore back. And then what about 1955, 1971, 2022? Does our understanding of whether or not this really was a disaster at that magnitude change over time? It would be rather astonishing if it didn't. Because as Galileo said, hey, it moves. So for the British, yes, they lost their place as the premier Western power in Asia. Yes, they did not lead the war against Japan. Yes, their prestige was shaken, and this really mattered to them because they had long known how thin the margin was between their physical strength and the capabilities of the territories they were governing to put up with it. Without systematic partnerships with local peoples, the British Empire could never have existed, nor most others, as a matter of fact. Right? So prestige had always been, in their view, a very, very, very important bedrock foundation stone of British Imperium in Asia. And it's not a historian who captures this best, it's Orwell. Burmese days, when we read how important prestige was to the British. Read his story about being a regional police officer in rural Burma and trying to deal with an elephant. And they were humiliated as a power. Yes, they were. The Japanese made sure of this by marching them through the streets of eastern Singapore on their way to Changi. Right? But on the other hand, the Allies won the war. The British actually took Singapore back, took Burma back by force, marched into Singapore after the Japanese surrender. They were about to invade it. The invasion was preempted by the nuclear attacks on Japan. They regained their imperial territories. Now, a few years later, some of them evolved into political independence, but the Union Jack flew again. And in the end, the British exit was through the negotiating table, not at the point of the gun. They, in South Asia, navigated their own way out years later. In particular, of course, they were instrumental in organizing Malaysia, the context within which, finally, British hard power exited Southeast Asia. And they did remain a major power. Increasingly, in fact, the Americans began to regret being so anti-European empire during the Second World War, when they realized in the early Cold War that they were up against it globally and could use the help of established powers who'd been in sensitive areas for a very long time, such as the French and the British. The British, with American support, remained a major power for some time, well into the Cold War years, into the late 1960s, when it all became too much for them to afford. And undoubtedly, their defeat in Singapore taught them a new flexibility. In their planning for reorganizing territories post-war, this planning occurring during the war, even the colonial office understood that things would have to change. Whereas before the war, British officials had tended to publicly and privately say, yes, yes, we're all working towards dominion status, but for brown and yellow countries, they meant, oh, sometime in a very indeterminate future. They weren't Canada, they weren't Australia. But by 1945, dominion status was very definitely the object, and the argument was, is this going to be in 10 years or 15 or 20? They understood that the question had changed. It's not would the British leave Asia, but when and how and in what terms. And increasingly, it became a focus on let's leave strong and solid relationships behind and good post-colonial partners. Some of that was the result of getting their head kicked in 1942 and learning to be more flexible with the partnerships that they were trying to maintain in Asia. The timeline here, 1942, yes, it was a real disaster. But in 1945, there was definite redemption. In fact, they made sure of this with British and Indian forces retaking all of the Southeast Asian territories. By 1960, Britain was undergoing a strong recovery in every sense of the word, economic, political. In 1971, that had all gone south. There was a big reorganization caused by Britain trying too hard for too long to remain in power beyond its means, and the withdrawal of British forces east of Suez was key to that. But look how it happened. This is a picture of the families of British service personnel up at Sembawang enjoying themselves in 1970. They're not being hustled out at the point of the bayonet or marched off to an internment camp or defeated by a hostile power. They're having a great time. Singapore was one of the most desirable postings for the British military during the Cold War. They loved living here. And Lee Kuan Yew didn't want them to leave because they were too important to the local economy. So yeah, fine, the British left, but they left a quarter century later in very different circumstances. It hardly looked like humiliation. If it was a disaster, it was a disaster from which they recovered, at least to some degree. By 1992, when you're talking 50th anniversary, it's a painful memory on a global canvas. Yeah, Britain had fought a Second World War, and yeah, we'd lost a few things. We'd been beaten in France in 1940. We'd been beaten in Singapore. But in the end, we won. So it had become more of a problematized item in a larger story. By 2022, is it even noticeable in British history? Really, it's only those who are interested in British history in Britain who will register to any degree the impact that the fall of Singapore had on Britain. You go to any 10 people in the streets of London and ask them, and you'll find three or four that know enough about it to give you an opinion. Well, others have their own timelines, the Japanese. At the time, they swept through Southeast Asia as an imperial conqueror. It was an impressive performance, no question about it. But in doing so, they greatly overextended their own power. Only one-fifth of their army was used in the operations in Southeast Asia. The rest was busy fighting in China or nervously watching the Soviet Union across the Manchurian border, with good reason, because they were not friends. So the Japanese were grossly overextended. The force-to-space ratio, which explains itself, how much manpower, and it was manpower at the time, do you have to cover how much territory? There were large swathes of Southeast Asia where people rarely, if ever, saw a Japanese soldier. They were so overextended. And that all fell apart fatally and really quickly in 1945. Remember, the Allies anticipated having to invade Japan and to conquer it in a fight that might take a year or more. With the sudden collapse as a result of the nuclear weapons, everybody, Japanese included, were caught off guard. The giant vacuum in Southeast Asia also included, like a balloon with the air popped out of it, the almost instant destruction of Japanese prestige in Southeast Asia, gone overnight. On the other hand, that led in Japan to a true revolution and eventually a renaissance. From being one of the most imperialist, militarist, belligerent states in the world, Japan became the most pacifist state in the world, the most unwilling to develop or even consider projecting military strength, even in participation with allies, even in causes that have been legitimized by authorities such as the United Nations. The great success in negotiating the end of the crisis in Cambodia, which led to the United Nations peacekeeping force in 1991, Japanese were careful to send a medical team and some policemen, no military. There was certainly a renaissance too, under the protection of the American nuclear umbrella and security alliance, able to spend much less than it really needed to on defense. Japan was able to rebuild its economy to an almost miraculous degree at such great pace that, of course, it's usually called the Japanese miracle. This was undoubtedly a new Japan emerging into a new Asia, carrying baggage, as we all know, complicating for sure. But even though the fall of Singapore led Japan down the road towards disaster in 1945, what died was Imperial Japan, Imperial militarist belligerent Japan. A new Japan emerged from within that society with the reputational burden to bear, even to this day, but not because it conquered Singapore, because of the way its troops behaved as occupying powers. Their timeline. In 1942, of course, there's glory and triumph, but it's very short-lived. In 1944, there's overstretched and they start to be taken apart. In 1945, there is total and truly fatal defeat. That state is terminated. But in 1955, Japan is already rebuilding itself, plural, on many levels, politically, psychologically, economically, diplomatically. For example, the Korean War, disaster for everybody else, bonanza for Japan. Huge kickstart to the post-war Japanese economic recovery. 1965, a new Japan playing a new role in Southeast Asia, once again diplomatically active, the biggest investor. When I first came to Singapore in 1993, the largest expatriate community in Singapore was the Japanese. That's no longer the case, but it was at the time. Finally, in 2022, Japan certainly seen as a full partner in a new Asia, a confident post-colonial assertive Asia. And yet there's that reputational burden. Anybody recognize the photo? You do, don't you? It's the old Japanese cemetery off Yochukang Road. And it dates back to the 1890s. It long predates the Second World War, which is one reason why it's still there. At the time, it was in the quiet countryside. Now it's completely surrounded by housing, but it's still maintained by the Japanese Association. And while many of the graves are of people who died well before the Second World War, prostitutes, Japan was for a long time a developing power, business people, traders, merchants, there are also those who died during the occupation or in the reconstruction phase thereafter. And there are memorials to the Japanese soldiers who fought during the Second World War. And there is even a memorial to the spirit of Field Marshal Terauchi, who died of disease in Saigon just after the Japanese surrender, and who commanded all Japanese forces in Southeast Asia, and who was a Class A war criminal and would unquestionably have been convicted and executed in Tokyo had he not died. But there's a memorial to his spirit there, which is left alone undisturbed. Why? Because it is a quiet, remote, low-profile piece of Singapore. So there is this new Japan and this new Asia, and yet there is still this reputational burden. It will take time. The day will come when Japanese behavior during the Second World War will be seen by the rest of Asia the same way that Napoleonic behavior in Spain is seen by the rest of Europe now, but that will take time. A long passage of time. So there is still that baggage to carry. Singapore's timeline. In 1942, it's absolute catastrophe. There's no question about that. This is undoubtedly the worst thing that ever happened to Singapore. Not only did a great many people get killed during the battle itself, but it also led to the horror of war ordeal of the occupation, of which we are all aware. I don't need to belabor this. But in 1945, there is rebirth. These aren't propaganda photos. These are Singaporeans welcoming back the returning British and Indian forces, liberating them in September 1945, and they are deliriously and sincerely happy. The main reason for this is they're going to get food, because for months now, the Japanese distribution system has been falling apart. The American Navy slaughtered the Japanese merchant marine, and everybody in Southeast Asia living in a town or a city was on the edge of famine. So this liberation did not come too soon. But there's a very interesting feature to this photo. Can anyone identify the flag being held by the little boy in the right forefront? Yeah, it's the Kuomintang flag, isn't it? It's not the Union Jack, right? Yeah. There are these very strong ties between the Singapore Chinese community and the Chinese authorities. And remember, in China, the government is still the Republic of China, whose flag that is, which has a strong political presence in Singapore. There is a fork in the road in 1948 when the political attempt to reorganize Malaya leads to the setting aside of the Union and its replacing by the Federation, but Singapore is excluded. And we all know why: military strategy and communal tensions. But because of that, the British never intended that this be permanent. They always regarded the peninsula and the island as linked. And one of the warnings that they mentioned to each other in colonial office discussions behind closed doors was, we must make sure that what happened to Ireland doesn't happen to Malaya. What they meant by that was the partition of Ireland. Dublin was the administrative capital of the country, but Belfast was its principal industrial port, and they were one economy. So the 1922 partition of Ireland was an economic disaster for the people of Ireland on both sides of the line. There was that concern here. Singapore was the industrial metropolitan port of Malaya. And the British never wished or wanted any such political separation to be permanent. But unwittingly, unintentionally, using hindsight, cheating, we can say this begins in 1948 when a Malayan project that will ultimately culminate in a sovereign kingdom of Malaya begins a new political experience on a divergent trajectory from what becomes the colony of Singapore. The Straits settlements cease to exist. Singapore becomes a colony in its own right. You're all well aware of the trauma of 1963-65. 1992, by the time of the 50th anniversary, we have a new Singapore, successful in every respect, confident, engaging the world. By 2022, I would argue we have a maturing Singapore, a Singapore that is willing to discuss difficult times in its past and complications in its relationships with the rest of Asia and the world then and now. Still unwilling to release its archives, but more able and willing to have a conversation about the tough times of its past than it had been. So in this Singapore timeline, in what way is 1942 the worst disaster? Well, arguably, it may please stay that way, because if anything worse than the fall of Singapore and the Japanese occupation happens to Singapore in the future, I don't want to be here. So simply by perspective and comparison, we can by default say, yes, this was the worst thing that happened to Singapore, but it wasn't catastrophic. Owning history. Who owns this history of the fall of Singapore as a disaster? Let's look regional. Let's make that the perspective. Can anyone recognize the photo? Good guess. The worst place to be in Southeast Asia during the Second World War was not Singapore, it was Manila, and it was Manila in the first 3 months of 1945. Absolutely the worst. Japanese pride had consequences. The Japanese did not want to relinquish anything that they had conquered, and they fought with a ferocity that outmatched any other belligerent for every position that they held. That reflected the brittleness of Japanese imperial society. Militarism had been imposed on a people which was deferential enough to accept it, but not really engaged enough with the rest of the world to own it viscerally. Japan failed utterly and completely to construct an Asian Rome. It all fell apart so rapidly that the end was terrible. And in fact, Singapore was only part of a much broader experience of occupation all over Southeast Asia. A relatively bad place to be in one sense, because there were a lot of Japanese garrison troops here, you couldn't avoid them. But a relatively useful place to be in another sense, because it was rarely attacked by the Allies, only late in the war, and it did not become an invasion site. The Allies retook Luzon by force. Singapore, they could walk into. And the Japanese fought for it. And the consequences of divide and rule in the Philippines, as well as in Singapore, were not positive. The Japanese contributed nothing positive to the ongoing difficulties of communal relations between the different communities in Malaya and Singapore. That's the best I can say about it. In fact, really, they tried to wedge the races apart by treating them differently, which only aggravated the problem for the future. And there were far more serious outcomes elsewhere in Southeast Asia, and Manila was the worst. Manila, not Singapore, was really the up-and-coming cultural center of Southeast Asia before the Second World War. That ended. And that ended because of where the heaviest fighting was in Manila, right in the middle of the central area of town, the CBD and the area where all the most influential people in the country live. It's as if the CBD and District 11 were destroyed in Singapore. Consequences linger to this day. So owning history, regional, there is more than one disaster. It's tough to say that the fall of Singapore was the worst disaster for Southeast Asia. I would say not even close. I would say that that unwanted honor goes to Manila. Owning history global, the most common local reference to this period is the Japanese occupation. That's often the chapter used in textbooks in secondary schools, for example, the Japanese occupation. But in fact, I've long argued that a better title is the Second World War, because that's what it was a part of. That's why the Japanese came here. And that's the better context in which to understand it. Singapore wasn't on the bullseye all by itself. It may be a little bit too far for you to read, but these are Dutch graves at Kranji Military Cemetery. Making a point here, the Dutch troops from the Netherlands East Indies cooperated in the defense of Malaya in a common cause, trying to defend the region against the Japanese onslaught. There are Dutch, there are New Zealand, there are Australian, as well as Malayan, Singaporean, a multinational harvest of death. And the fall of Singapore, well, as I say, certainly of more interest to Singapore than anyone else, but definitely fits into regional and global history and doesn't belong just to Singapore alone. As I mentioned, for example, one of the worst defeats the British Indian Army ever suffered. We're nearly done. Worst disaster. Depends on who's involved. Depends on the time frame that you're talking about and the context that you're looking within. 80 years is long enough to determine an impact on state, society, and order, global and regional, is it? I think you could argue this either way, right? I mean, defeat didn't prevent Japan from rebuilding itself and becoming an indispensable major player in Asian affairs, but it didn't doom the British to instant total humiliation and decline either. It's certainly long enough for us to get an understanding of some of the significant repercussions, all of them. There's no way to really resolve this. I mean, everybody will formulate their own view on what time frame best captures the full repercussions of an event of this sort. 5 years is clearly too short. 200 to 300 years may be unnecessarily long. It really depends on what you're talking about. Was a disaster in terms of being able to remain a major power or a significant force, or do you mean in some other way? In terms of the British, no, I really can't say that it was their worst disaster, and that's been clear since 1945. But the most you can go is the worst military disaster in the war against Japan and under Winston Churchill's direction. Japanese, no, the worst disaster was obviously the attacks on Hiroshima and Nagasaki that made the repercussions of what happened in Singapore pale into insignificance, but it wasn't, you know, completely irrelevant either. It was a brick in the path that led Japan towards that terrible, ultimate, catastrophic finale. Singapore, yes, I would say yes. And I would say that it's even clearer now than it was in 1945. Singapore has gone on to be a great success in almost every sense of the word by any context of measurement that you would care to evaluate. And that perhaps makes this all the more clear. Nothing anywhere near this bad has happened to or in Singapore since. So kind of by mechanical process of elimination, maybe we can say for Singapore at least, yes, this might have been the worst disaster in its history. So perhaps Churchill was almost right. I've got an epilogue for you. I bet you'll all remember this. After a noted and heated pushback led by such luminaries as Prof. Wang Gungwu and Chen Hengqi, the Ford factory and museum was forced to make this amendment. Clearly, this all still resonated strongly enough that it was a hot button emotional topic. But I have one final thought to consider. If this happened not in 2017, but in 2050 or something, would there be any pushback? Would anybody care? Would the reaction be as visceral or emotional as this? Of course, I don't know. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Brian, for a very insightful and fascinating talk. There's time now for questions. If you have any questions, I ask you to identify yourself and then post your question. Those of you who are in Zoom, please put your questions in the chat room and we will read it out to Brian for him to answer.
And my apologies to those who replied to my questions in the middle of my talk on the chat. I couldn't see it because I was looking at the slides. So thanks for that. And you were indeed right. It was the Japanese cemetery. For the Zoom people.
Okay, since everyone's still thinking, I'm gonna go ahead and ask my question, although it's not yet totally formulated in my head. I'm very interested too in the statement, of course, of Churchill, which labeled what happened here 80 years ago as the worst disaster in British military history. Now, you have evaluated rather quite strongly how this was not at all disastrous for anybody, right, who were involved in Singapore in the long term, right? You have a short term and a long term perspective of the whole thing. But I think you have not fully discussed the idea of disaster for British military history on Churchill himself. Could you give us a little bit more about how making such a statement had been advantageous or been disadvantageous for somebody like Churchill, who's clearly a person of great intellectual prowess that can use words to mobilize people? What had such a statement done for Churchill, for instance, in short term, in the middle term, in the long term, it's clear. Sure. I mean, we're talking about the darn professor who's you know, so far from us 80 years on. So please give us a little bit
more on that. Happy to. Yeah, okay. So immediately at the time, Churchill was forced to promise Parliament that there would be an inquiry into why Singapore fell. Because this followed on the heels of a year and a half of defeats. They'd lost in France, they'd lost in Crete, they'd lost in North Africa. Things didn't seem to be going well at all. Why couldn't we fight better? Why was the war slipping from our grasp? And the only reason he got away with not having an immediate public inquiry was because the coalition government, with Labour Party in support, all agreed that the war had to be dealt with first, and that the information useful to the enemy might come up from an open inquiry, so that would have to be postponed, right? And Churchill was rescued from further political trouble over that by two things. Number one, he had established from the day he took office in May 1940, the very sensible habit for a politician of being as honest as he could with his people as often as possible and not sparing them bad news. So a large reservoir of trust had grown up between him and the British public that even if things weren't going as well as they should, and who the hell would do something about it, Winston wasn't going to sugarcoat it or sidestep it or pretend it wasn't happening, right? So there's that. And second, the Allies rather quickly began to do better, particularly in the war in Europe. Also, of course, the Americans are now in the war, and that gives everybody the sense that, all right, we're going through a tough patch, but things have improved and we'll move forward, right? Then Churchill, in the medium term, is kind of taken off the hook by the fact that he loses the election in 1945. So the decision as to whether or not there should be a post-war public inquiry in the fall of Singapore actually falls to the Labour Party and the man who succeeded him as Prime Minister, Clement Attlee. And after a long discussion in 1946, they decide not to, on the grounds that this would raise too many questions about how the British Empire was administered and defended overall. It might indict the entire system. And at that point, they were still trying to maintain and reinvent it. Also, it would raise a lot of acrimony with the Australians and the Indians. So they decided to punt it to the historians. The commanders would file their official reports, and in due course, the historians would evaluate it. And maybe one day a future government would want to investigate it, but not now while the empire was still a going concern. No chance. So that kind of spared Churchill those immediate post-war years, which meant that by the time he was finally publishing his memoirs and once again prime minister, and they were a bestseller and everybody was fascinated by it, he could safely take the risk of slotting back into his wartime mode of being brutally honest with people about what was happening and why, and he did so. Because by then he was speaking of the entire panorama of an ordeal successfully survived, a war successfully won, a great triumph achieved. And this could be put in its place as one of a number of deeply painful, significant defeats that needed to be understood. So in the end, I think that events just passed him by. Right? Where, however, it really comes through, the reason he used that specific label, is in the correspondence that he had with the people who were helping him write his memoirs. And a syndicate, a team of about five or six people who had served under him during the war as either civilian assistants or senior military advisors. And they helped him do the research, and they wrote rough drafts for him and things like that. And one of the long conversations that he had in person and in correspondence regarding the defense and fall of Malaya and Singapore, he writes rather plaintively, "I just never really got a grip on this. You know, I was focusing on Europe. I never really understood how vulnerable Singapore was. I should have done more. I didn't. I really just didn't get a grip on it." We can see that coming out in his labeling of this as the worst disaster. He clearly thinks it was one of the worst mistakes he made as a wartime prime minister, and almost said that very thing in his memoirs. He also had to bear in mind that he owed something to those who were unfortunate enough to be stationed at the beginning of a war in places that the British weren't really prepared to defend effectively. It was certainly a disaster for them. Not only those who lost their lives, but also those who spent the rest of their war in a prisoner of war camp, many of whom wound up dying prematurely young years later because of the terrible conditions they endured as captives of the Japanese. Those people, Churchill felt, deserved an honest accounting, or as honest an accounting as he could give them of what had happened. In the end, that whole chapter amounts to him admitting, "We just screwed this one up."
So he was just articulating basically a very populist idea, mm-hmm. And that should be, I think, taken into consideration.
Yeah, definitely. He's an unusually honest politician, but of course the argument would be that during war that's a wise thing to do, and he could afford to be so. Yeah. Thanks, Marcia.
That was Steve.
Sure. Okay, Victor Nurcombe, my old and dear friend. Was the effect of the Japanese occupation of Malaya as profound on Malayans as it was on Singapore? That's a very good question, and I'm going to give you a two-faceted answer, Vic. First, I'm going to say that it was more nuanced because Malaya was a much larger space. So there were wide varieties of experience between those who lived in, for example, urban Ipoh or KL, which were Japanese garrison towns, and those who lived in small Malay kampongs in the remote Hulu and who never saw a Japanese soldier. Whereas in Singapore, the experience was far more centralized. I mean, not a lot of variations other than ethnic community. Everybody lived in an urban space. So it's the space of Malaya and the distribution of the population. That's one thing. But the other is the Japanese approach to it. The Japanese approach to an entity that they thought might be detached and brought under the Japanese umbrella in creating a new family of Japanese-led states. And that's created a bit of an argument. You have, on the one hand, historians who argue that the occupation had a significant impact on Malaya and affected its post-war politics and society, especially by aggravating relations between the communities. And you have, on the other, historians such as Paul Pratoska, who said that the Japanese occupation was kind of like an episode, you know, a scar on the skin tissue that only went skin deep and didn't really leave any lasting lingering effects. And it didn't affect, it didn't have any effect other than enhancing things that were already in play. Malay nationalism, the Chinese communal concerns, the tension between the Kuomintang and the communists, all of those things. So I would say that what we get out of this, or what I get out of this, is that the problem of the impact of the Japanese occupation on Malaya is much more interesting than the problem of the Japanese occupation and its effect on Singapore, because it is more complicated, it is more nuanced. Malaya is a bigger place, more complicated, more considerations to evaluate. Yeah. A long-winded way of saying, yeah, to an extent. Please.
Let me attempt to organize my question as well, because I think it was pretty poignant when you mentioned that the occasion of the 80th anniversary is different from the 60th anniversary because you're using the people who have personal memories of the war. And this year we've just marked, well, the world has just marked the passing of Queen Elizabeth II. Mm-hmm. We have not been a colony for a very long time, but even so, I do, and certainly I don't feel the same way for the late Queen as mm-hmm. the British do, but to me, her significance was that she her lifespan and her reign certainly spanned the loss of empire, decolonization, and also the dramatic changes in the UK. And so there's definitely a period of reflection in the UK right now that she's passed. So as you mentioned, the 80th anniversary is a period of reflection for us. So I guess the question is, if the fall of Singapore may not have been as big of a disaster as you seem to imply, how would that affect the national narrative for Singapore, for whom, you know, the fall of Singapore, as you pointed out earlier in your seminar, that is used to justify things like toll defense, mm-hmm. the importance of national service, mm-hmm. how would that narrative change? Are there examples that we can draw from similar experiences in the region from the war? How do you think that would change?
That's so murky in an unpredictable future that I'm going to go in another direction to that answer. How might Singapore's circumstances change, bearing in mind its history? Finland's historical memory as a neighbor of Russia was that it was only because of the Russian Revolution that it was able to rebel and reinvent itself as a sovereign state once again. For a couple of centuries, Finland was a province of the Russian Empire, but the Bolsheviks lost it because they were unable to prevent it from leaving in the midst of the revolution. And after they consolidated their power, they thought it was too troublesome to try and take back. But in 1939, when Stalin thought that he would have a settling of accounts with Hitler sooner or later, he invaded Finland, underestimated them. The Finns gave him a bloody nose. So he regrouped, sent in a great deal more forces, made it clear enough to the Finns that although the Russians were going to be heavily punished, they would in the end extinguish Finland. So the Finns cut a deal with them. All right, we'll lose some territory and we'll remain a satellite of yours and we'll remain independent. And then a year and a half later, the Germans invade the Soviet Union and the Finns really very unwisely decide to throw their lot in with the Germans and join their invasion of the Soviet Union. So in 1944, when the war is going badly for Germany and its allies, the Finns are in trouble again. They go to Stalin and they say, okay, sorry about that. What can we do? So what emerges is something called Finlandization for the next 70 years. Finland is a neutral country. It does not join any bloc. It doesn't support any bloc. And it gives an assurance to the Soviet Union in word and in deed that Finland will not allow any other power to use Finnish land or airspace in any way that's menacing or threatening to Russia. And the Finns are comfortable and secure in this, and they think that that's given them a kind of exit path from the front line of geopolitical conflict in Europe. And in the Cold War, it looks like that's the case. Well, look what's happened in the last few months. You know, the Finns have decided, the Russians really are a menace and we have to watch out. But how do they respond to this? What distinguishes Singapore from other states in situations to which you can compare it, such as Sweden, Finland, Switzerland, Israel, wishing to stay apart from the geopolitics of its region in terms of military conflict or potential military conflict, what distinguishes them from all of this is really nothing. They're all armed to the teeth. I mean, Finland is now a desirable acquisition for NATO because the price of Finland remaining neutral was that it wanted to present a credible problem to anyone on either side who would try and violate the understanding that it reached with the Soviets in 1945. If the Soviets decided they'd run out of patience and wanted Finland, the Finns were going to make them fight for it. If NATO decided they needed Finland, Finland was going to make them fight for it. There is this rather naive view in some quarters of the West in particular that neutrality means a free ride on defense, whereas most of those who attempt to be militarily neutral from their region, and Singapore's a little awkward there because it is and it isn't, instead arm themselves to the teeth. Every adult male in Switzerland, Israel's almost constantly at war, Sweden and Finland are two of the most heavily armed countries in Europe. I don't see this changing. And of all of those countries, Switzerland and Singapore are probably in the most fortunate situation. Singapore has ongoing defense relations with Malaysia, which, despite the best efforts of Mr. Mahathir, have not been too bad over the years. Its relations with Indonesia have improved more than people like me ever thought they would. I mean, Indonesia's ability to avert imploding in disaster has been the great Southeast Asian success story of the 21st century. Singapore's benefited from that. And Singapore has no particular reason to think that it's going to have any troubles with its neighbors, but it remains armed to the teeth. And I'm not suggesting that it shouldn't. So you asked me a good question, but it's one which I answer with trepidation, because I think that extrapolating anything that far into a future whose key issues are too uncertain takes us almost into meteorology without computers. I have a six-year-old son. He's a Singaporean. His mother doesn't want him to do national service. Moms. I say two things to her. Number one, no 18-year-old listens to their mother. Number two, yes, it's very likely that 12 years from now there will still be national service in Singapore. In fact, I bet on it. Not necessarily because there's any threat, but simply because of the structural characteristics of Singapore and its place in the region. So does what happened in 1942 have any role in that? Really only as something that Singaporeans can point to without being propagandists. Unless they're exaggerating its importance or exaggerating the connection between it and what they wish to speak about. If they're simply pointing out, this just reminds us that you never know what will happen, and that while you have good connections with powerful friends, at the end of the day, the only people who will always see your security as the constant priority are yourselves. That's a pretty good testimony from history with the empirical evidence right there in front of you. So you shouldn't exaggerate it, but critically and sensibly positioned in a national narrative, I think it's probably going to have a place for a long, long time.
Sure, whether anyone else has chipped in or not.
No.
Can I ask a simple question?
Please.
Thank you so much for your wonderful talk,
Thank you.
Professor Farrell. I
actually I'm interested in their prisoners of war, especially their ration system. When they work for the worker party, they were given extra ration. But basically, I heard daily just a half a cup of rice was given to them as a ration. I want to know how serious it was there when it compared to the other camp under the Japanese occupation. When they are sent to their Borneo and Hainan, their case was worse. I heard like that. I just want to know the ration system between the camps under the Japanese occupation and also comparison between their Singaporean under the Japanese occupation and POW. Thank you.
Odds of survival if you were a prisoner of war under the Japanese and you were able to stay in Singapore were much higher. If you were sent out on any of the work parties to the railway in Thailand or the mines in Hainan, your chances of dying were much greater. And the two reasons for that seem to be that the labor that was required of the POWs in Singapore was nowhere near as arduous, and that food and medical care was available on at least a higher level than it was in these remote occupation task forces sent out in other places. Something we don't know enough about because of the wholesale of Japanese records destruction in 1945 is how much this had to do with individual choices made by individual commanders in individual camps. The only window that we have into that are the various war crimes trials that were held in Singapore and other places, which elicited testimony from Allied POWs, sometimes condemning Japanese suspects who were under indictment, but sometimes speaking up on their behalf as well. This person had tried to help us, he tried to mitigate things. And in Singapore, it appears that there were some bad actors, some of the more senior Japanese camp guards and formation commanders were found guilty and executed. But there were a number also who were character witnesses testified on their behalf, Allied POW, saying that these people had looked the other way when we got food supplies from friendly local civilians or had made sure that Red Cross packages got to us. So it's probably to some degree influenced by something as unpredictable as the personal choices of the individual Japanese commandants themselves. Whether they're all on their own with no one overlooking them on the death railway in Thailand, hundreds of kilometers from a town, or whether they're running a camp right here in Singapore, where a very senior officer could come down anytime from headquarters and inspect them, and so they had to be ready to bear that. We simply don't know, and I wonder if we'll ever have a really substantial answer, because so many of these people did not survive the war, and so many Japanese army records in particular were destroyed in Tokyo in 1945. But if you're just going by the crude metric of numbers, your best chance of survival as an Allied POW in Southeast Asia was if you were in Singapore and you weren't sent out anywhere else.
Right, okay.
Okay, Vincent, thank you very much. Let's be clear on this. There's no doubt that the reason the Americans entered the Second World War is the Japanese attacked them. But long before that, the Americans and the British had already decided they were going to make common cause. And they were talking secretly about concerting their war efforts and following a common strategy. They even made a general overall priority agreement, Germany first. They would deal with Germany first. So when the Japanese attacked everybody at the same time, that just made formal something that was already coming together, just accelerated the process. The Americans were naturally very upset and disappointed that Singapore was taken by the Japanese, but it was part of an ongoing litany of disaster from Hawaii all the way to Burma. I mean, they were in the process of fighting for and losing control of the Philippines while the British were losing control of Singapore. So they really regarded it as part and parcel of the much larger problem of the Japanese catching the West off guard in Southeast Asia and pushing them out. Right? It was seen as a setback which they understood would complicate Britain's ability to continue to fight in the war against Japan. And the first consequence, which became clear only weeks later and was forthrightly engaged by the Allied High Command, was that it's obvious that the Japanese had gotten in between them. By pushing into Southeast Asia, they'd separated British India and Australia and American Hawaii. And Australia had fallen on the other side of the Japanese. So Australia, up till that point, had been working as a junior partner with the British. They now shifted into the American orbit and cooperated with American forces in the war against Japan. The British were pushed back into the Indian Ocean. The Australians were dragged up into the Pacific. That the Japanese forced on the Allies by taking the central position. But the Allies quickly realized this and reorganized accordingly and fought back from there. There was one more question.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you, Vincent. From Sarah. Right. Okay, I'm going to read this out. In Singapore, is the anger mostly amongst older persons, question mark, over Singapore government's actions over Queen Elizabeth's death, for example, flags at half-mast, and the question over the existence of the Commonwealth, somewhat due to perception, i.e. poor public reputation and the dominant narrative over British colonial rule, for example, opium trade leading to the death penalty, and that the British betrayed Singapore during the Second World War? Sarah, I don't think that's an unreasonable question, especially given the earlier one, but I'm going to take the coward's way out and say, look, I'm not Singaporean. So it's really going to have to be someone from Singapore who should address that and say why they think the Singapore government has done this or what the public reaction is. What I can say is I wrote at their request an editorial for Channel News Asia last week, and they asked me about Commonwealth reactions to the death of Elizabeth and what the future held. And my argument was that for a long time now in my country, Canada, and in other Commonwealth countries in which the Queen was still the head of state, and she is not in Singapore, right? For a long time now, the prevailing view had been, you know, it probably is time we started to think about being a republic and at least discuss it, but not while the Queen is alive. And polls showed that that was overwhelming in countries like Canada and Australia, because there was such respect for her personally and the way she carried herself and behaved and carried out her role. But it also suggested that that respect was for her personally more than the institution, right? And I went on to say that, in my view, she probably understood this, and that might help explain why she worked so hard for so long to focus not on her head of state role overseas, but on her Commonwealth role. I think she figured out earlier than most everybody else that the Commonwealth, being adaptable and flexible, it decided it would accommodate republics and it would become a voluntary organization, which would be whatever its members wanted it to be and do whatever its members wanted it to do, right? That was something that could usefully be preserved, and she threw herself into it. It looks like it became her life's work. So in the end, I concluded that there's a bicentennial coming up in New Zealand in 2040, the 200th anniversary of the Treaty of Waitangi between the British Crown and the Maori, which leads to British settlement in New Zealand. By that time, I would expect not to be surprised if New Zealand and Canada are now republics, but I would be certain that they are both still in the Commonwealth. I think that's her impact, that she, as she did with decolonization, made it possible for people to revise and reorganize rather than simply split and walk away, never to play together again. That's the best I can come up with, but that's no small achievement in my view. But thank you, Sarah. Sorry to be a coward and not speak for Singapore.
Okay, it looks like it's time's up. We've reached the end of the allotted time. It leaves me great pleasure to present a token of appreciation to Brian.
Thank you very much. Thank you. How nice.
You like it?
Yeah, very much.
This afternoon, this is a bit of publicity. This afternoon, we have another talk scheduled at 4 o'clock by Dr. Darren Neo, who is the head of the Lee Kong Chian National Natural History Museum in NUS. And his topic is changing landscapes and biodiversity in Singapore's fresh waters. And it's still not too late to sign up if you're interested. Thank you.
Thank you all. Give me a Starbucks.
Hi.
Want to go have a coffee?
I know.